Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Templar Knight by Jan Guillou, narrated by Gildart Jackson. Chapter 1. During Muharram, the holy month of mourning, which occurred when the summer was at its hottest in the year 575 after Hijra, called Anno Domini 1177 by the infidels, God sent his most remarkable deliverance to those of his faithful he loved best. Yusuf and his brother Fakhra were riding for their lives, and right behind, shielding them from the enemy's arrows, came the emir Musa. Their pursuers, who were six in number, were steadily gaining on them, and Yusuf cursed his arrogance, which had made him believe that something like this would never happen, since he and his companions possessed the swiftest of horses. But the landscape here in the Valley of Death and Drought, due west of the Dead Sea, was just as inhospitably arid as it was rocky. This made it dangerous to ride too fast, although their pursuers seemed completely unhampered by this. But if one of them happened to take a spill, it would be no less fateful than if any of the men being chased should fall. Yusuf suddenly decided to cut across to the west and head up toward the mountains, where he hoped to find cover. Before long, the three pursued horsemen were following a wadi, a dry riverbed up a steep slope. But the wadi began to narrow and deepen, so that they were soon riding in a long ravine, as if God had caught them in flight and was now steering them in a specific direction. Now there was only one road, and it led upward, growing steeper and steeper, making it harder and harder to keep up their speed. And their pursuers were coming steadily closer. They would soon be within shooting range. The men being chased had already fastened their round ironclad shields to their backs. Yusuf was not in the habit of praying for his life, but now, as he was forced to decrease his speed more and more among all the treacherous boulders at the bottom of the wadi, a verse came to him from God's word, which he breathlessly rattled off with parched lips. "He who has created life and death in order to test you and allow you to prove who among you by his actions is the best, he is the Almighty, the one who always forgives." And God did indeed test his beloved Yusuf, and showed him, first as a mirage against the light of the setting sun, and then with terrible clarity, the most horrific sight that any of the faithful in such a hunted and difficult situation could see. From the opposite direction, in the wadi, came a Templar knight with lowered lance, and behind him rode his sergeant. Both of these foes were riding at such speed that their mantles billowed behind them like great dragon wings. They came like genii out of the desert. Yusuf abruptly reined in his horse and fumbled with his shield, which he now had to pull around to the front to face the infidel's lance. He felt no fear, only a cold excitement at the nearness of death, and he steered his horse over to the steep wall of the wadi to present a narrower target and increase the angle of the enemy's lance. But then the Templar knight, who was only a few breaths away, raised his lance and waved his shield as a signal to Yusuf and his brother to move aside and get out of their way. They complied at once, and the next moment the two Templar knights thundered past as they let their mantles fall, which fluttered to the dust behind them. Yusuf quickly issued an order to his companions. With difficulty, their horses' hooves slipping, they clambered up the steep slope of the wadi until they reached a spot from which they had a good view. There Yusuf turned his horse around and stopped, for he wished to understand what God meant by all of this. The two others wanted to take advantage of the opportunity and escape, while the Templar knights and bandits settled matters as they saw fit. But Yusuf rejected all such arguments with a curt gesture of annoyance, because he truly wanted to see what would happen next. He had never in all his life been this close to a Templar knight, those demons of evil, and he felt strongly, as if God's voice were advising him, that he had to see what was going to happen. Mere common sense would not stop him. Common sense dictated that they should continue their ride toward Al-Arish for as long as the light permitted, but what he now saw he would never forget. The six bandits had few choices once they discovered that instead of chasing three wealthy men, they were now facing two Templar knights, lance to lance. The wadi was much too narrow for them to be able to stop, turn around, and beat a retreat before the Franks were upon them. After a brief hesitation, they did the only thing they could do. They grouped themselves, so they were riding two by two, and spurred their horses so as not to be killed by standing still. The white-clad Templar knight who rode in front of his sergeant first feigned an attack to the right of the first two bandits, and when they held up their shields to counter the dreaded blow of his lance, Yusuf wondered whether the bandits understood what now awaited them, the Templar knight spun his horse around with a swift movement that shouldn't have been possible in such tight quarters. This gave him a whole new vantage point, and he thrust his lance right between the shield and body of the bandit on the left. At the same time, he released his lance so as not to be wrenched out of his saddle. Just at that moment, the sergeant came in contact with the astonished bandit on the right, who was huddled behind his shield, waiting for the blow that never came, and who now looked up only to see the other foe's lance coming toward his face from the wrong direction. The white-clad man with the loathsome red cross now faced the next two enemies in a passageway so narrow that there was barely room for three horses abreast. He had drawn his sword, and at first it looked as if he intended to attack head-on, which would have been unwise with a weapon on only one side. But suddenly he turned his handsome steed sideways, a roan at the height of its powers, and lashed out behind him, striking one of the bandits and toppling him out of the saddle. The second bandit then saw a good opportunity, since the enemy was approaching him sideways, almost backward, with his sword in the wrong hand and out of reach. What he did not notice was that the Templar knight had dropped his shield and switched his sword to his left hand. When the bandit leaned forward in the saddle to strike with his saber, he exposed his whole neck and head to the blow, which now came from the opposite direction. If the head can retain a thought at the moment of death, if only for a brief breath, then that was a very surprised head that fell to the ground, said Fakhra in amazement. He, too, was now captivated by the drama and wanted to see more. The last two bandits had exploited the moment of decreased speed that had befallen the white-clad Templar knight as he dispatched the other bandit. They had turned their horses around and were now fleeing down the wadi. At that moment, the black-clad sergeant reached the godless dog who had been knocked to the ground by the Templar knight's horse. The sergeant dismounted, calmly grabbed the reins of the bandit's horse with one hand, and with the other used his sword to stab the dazed, reeling, and no doubt bruised bandit in the throat at the spot where his steel-plated leather coat of mail ended. But then the sergeant no longer made any attempt to follow his master, who had now put on speed to chase down the last two fleeing bandits. Instead, the sergeant hobbled the horse he had just caught with the reins, and then cautiously began rounding up the other loose horses, seeming to talk to them reassuringly. He did not appear at all worried about his master, whom he had been following so closely to offer protection. Instead, he seemed to think it more important to gather up the enemy's horses. It was truly a strange sight. That man, said Emir Musa, pointing toward the white-clad Templar knight who was far down the wadi and about to disappear from the sight of the three faithful. That man there, sire, is Al-Guti. Al-Guti? Said Yusuf, puzzled. You say his name as if I should know him, but I do not. Who is Al Guti? Al Guti is a man you should know, sire, replied Emir Musa resolutely. He is the man God sent to us for our sins. He is the one among the devils of the Red Cross who sometimes ride with the Turkopoles and sometimes with their heavy horsemen. Now, as you can see, he is riding an Arabian stallion as a Turkopole does, but carrying a lance and sword as if he were seated on one of the slow and heavy Frankish horses. He is also the emir of the Knights Templar in Gaza. Al Guti, Al Guti, muttered Yusuf thoughtfully. I would like to meet him. We will wait here. The two others looked at him in horror, but realized at once that he had made up his mind, so it would do no good to offer any objections, no matter how wise. While the three Saracen horsemen waited at the top of the wadi's slope, they watched the Templar Knight's sergeant, seemingly unperturbed and as though carrying out the most ordinary daily task. He had rounded up the horses of the four dead men. He then tied them together and started lugging and dragging the corpses of the bandits. With great effort, although he appeared to be a very powerful man, he hoisted them up and bound them hand and foot, each dead man slung over his own horse. The Templar Knight and the two remaining bandits, who had been the pursuers but were now the pursued, could no longer be seen. "Very clever," muttered Fakhr, as if to himself. "That is clever. He ties the right man to the right horse to keep the animals calm in spite of the blood. He is obviously thinking of taking the horses along with them." "Yes, they are truly fine horses," agreed Yusuf. "What I do not understand is how such criminals could have horses that are fit for a king. Their horses kept pace with our own." "Worse than that, they were closing on us at the end," observed Emir Musa, who never hesitated to speak his mind to his lord. "But haven't we seen enough? Wouldn't it be wise to ride off now into the darkness before Al Guti comes back?" "Are you certain that he will come back?" asked Yusuf. "Yes, sire, he will come back," replied Emir Musa morosely. "I am just as certain of that as the sergeant is down there. He hasn't even troubled to follow his master when there are only two enemies to fight. Didn't you notice that Al Guti had thrust his sword into its sheath and had pulled out his bow and stretched it taut just as he came around the bend down there?" "He pulled out a bow? A Templar knight?" asked Yusuf in surprise, raising his slender eyebrows. "Yes, he did, sire," replied Emir Musa. "He is a Turkopole, as I said. Sometimes he travels light and shoots from the saddle, like a Turk, except his bow is bigger. Far too many of the faithful have died from his arrows. I would still dare to suggest, sire, that—" "No," Yusuf cut him off. "We will wait here. I want to meet him. We have a truce with the Knights Templar right now, and I want to thank him. I owe him my gratitude, and I refuse even to consider being indebted to a Templar knight." The two others could see it would do no good to argue any further, but they were uneasy, and all conversation ceased. They sat there in silence for a while, leaning forward with one hand resting on the pommel of their saddles as they watched the sergeant, who was now done with the bodies and horses. He had started gathering the weapons and the cloaks that both he and his master had flung off right before the attack. After a while he picked up the severed head in one hand, and for a moment it looked as if he were wondering how to pack it up. At last he pulled the headdress off one of the bandits, wrapped it around the head, and made a parcel which he tied onto the pommel of the saddle over which the body with the missing head was slung. Finally, the sergeant was finished with all his tasks. He made sure all of the packs were fastened securely, and then mounted his horse and began slowly leading his caravan of linked horses past the three Saracens. Yusuf then greeted the sergeant politely in Frankish with a wave of his arm. The sergeant gave him an uncertain smile in return, but they could not hear what he said. Dusk began to fall, the sun had dropped behind the high mountains to the west, and the salt water of the sea far below no longer gleamed blue. The horses seemed to sense their master's impatience. They tossed their heads and snorted now and then, as if they too wanted to get moving before it grew too late. But then they saw the white-clad Templar Knight returning along the wadi. In tow behind him came two horses with two dead men draped over the saddles. He was in no hurry and rode with his head lowered, making him look as if he were lost in prayer, even though he was probably just keeping an eye on the rocky, uneven ground. He did not appear to have seen the three waiting horsemen, although from his vantage point they must have been visible, silhouetted against the light part of the evening sky. But when he reached them, he looked up and reined in his horse without saying a word. Yusuf felt at a loss, as if he had been struck dumb, because what he now saw did not coincide with what he had witnessed only a short time ago. This spawn of the devil, who was openly called Al-Guti, radiated peace. He had hung his helmet by a chain over his shoulder. His short, fair hair and his thick, unkempt beard of the same colour framed a demon's face with eyes that were as blue as you might expect. But here was a man who had just killed three or four other men. In the excitement, Yusuf had not been able to keep track of how many, even though he usually could recall everything he saw in battle. Yusuf had seen many men after a victory, just after they had killed and won, but he had never seen anyone who looked as if he had come from a day's work, as if he had been harvesting grain in the fields or sugarcane in the marshes, with the clear conscience that only good work can provide. His blue eyes were not the eyes of a demon. "We were waiting for you. We wish to thank you," said Yusuf, in a semblance of Frankish that he hoped the other man would understand. The man who was called Al-Guti in the language of the faithful gazed at Yusuf steadily, as his face slowly lit up with a smile, as if he were searching his memory and had found what he sought. This made Emir Musa and Fakhra, but not Yusuf, cautiously, almost unconsciously, drop their hands to their weapons beside their saddles. The Templar Knight quite clearly saw their hands, which now seemed to be moving of their own accord, toward their sabres. Then he raised his glance to the three on the slope, looked Yusuf straight in the eyes, and replied in God's own language. "In the name of God the Merciful, we are not enemies at this time, and I seek no strife with you. Consider these words from your own scripture, the words which the prophet himself, may peace be with him, spoke. Take not another man's life. God has declared it holy, except in a righteous cause. You and I have no righteous cause, for there is now a truce between us." The Templar Knight smiled even wider, as if he wanted to entice them to laugh. He was fully aware of the impression he must have made on the three foes when he addressed them in the language of the Holy Quran. But Yusuf, who now realized that he had to be quick-witted and swift to take command of the situation, answered the Templar Knight after only a slight hesitation. "The ways of God the Almighty are truly unfathomable." And to that the Templar Knight nodded, as if these words were particularly familiar to him. "And only he can know why he sent an enemy to save us. But I owe you my thanks, Knight of the Red Cross, and I will give you some of the riches that these infidels wanted. In this place where I now sit, I will leave 100 dinars in gold, and they belong by rights to you for saving our lives." Yusuf now thought that he had spoken like a king, and a very generous king, as kings should be. But to his surprise, and that of his brother and Emir Musa, the Templar Knight replied at first with a laugh that was completely genuine and without scorn. "In the name of God the Merciful, you speak to me out of both goodness and ignorance," said the Templar Knight. "From you I can accept nothing. What I did here I had to do, whether you were present or not. And I own no worldly possessions, and cannot accept any. That is one reason. Another reason is that the way around my vow is for you to donate the 100 dinars to the Knights Templar. But if you will permit me to say so, my unknown foe and friend, I think you would have difficulty explaining that gift to your prophet." With these words, the Templar Knight gathered up his reins, cast a glance back at the two horses and the two bodies he had in tow, and urged his Arabian horse on as he raised his right hand with clenched fist toward the men in the salute of the Templar Knights. He looked as if he found the situation quite amusing. "Wait," said Yusuf, so quickly that his words came faster than his thoughts. "Then I invite you and your sergeant instead to share our evening meal." The Templar Knight reined in his horse and looked at Yusuf with a thoughtful expression. "I accept your invitation, my unknown foe and friend," the Templar Knight replied, "but only on the condition that I have your word. None of you intends to draw a weapon against me or my sergeant, as long as we are in one another's company." "You have my word on the name of the true God and his prophet," replied Yusuf quickly. "Do I have yours?" "Yes, you have my word on the name of the true God, his son, and the Holy Virgin," replied the Templar Knight just as quickly. "If you ride 2 fingers south of the spot where the sun went down behind the mountains, you will reach a stream. Follow it to the northwest, and you will find several low trees near some water. Stay there for the night. We will be farther west, up on the slope, near the same water that flows toward you, but we will not sully the water. It will soon be night, and you have your hour for prayers, as do we. But afterward, when we come in the darkness to you, we will make enough noise so you hear us, and not come quietly, like someone with evil intentions." The Templar Knight spurred his horse, again saluted in farewell, got his little caravan moving, and rode off into the twilight, without looking back. The three faithful watched him for a long time, without moving or saying a word. Their horses snorted impatiently, but Yusuf was lost in thought. "You are my brother, and nothing you do or say should surprise me any more after all these years," said Fakhra. "But what you just did really surprised me. A Templar knight? And the one they call Al-Ghuti at that?" "Fakhra, my beloved brother," replied Yusuf as he turned his horse with an easy movement to head in the direction described by his foe, "you must know your enemy. We have talked a great deal about that, haven't we? And among your enemies, isn't it best to learn from the one who is most monstrous of all? God has given us this golden opportunity. Let us not refuse his gift." "But can we trust the word of such a man?" objected Fakhra, after they had been riding for a time in silence. "Yes, we can. As a matter of fact," muttered Emir Musa, "the enemy has many faces, known and unknown, but that man's word we can trust, just as he can trust your brothers." They followed their foe's instructions and soon found the little stream with fresh, cold water where they stopped to let their horses drink. Then they continued along the stream and, exactly as the Templar Knight had said, came to a level area. There the stream spread out to a small pond where low trees and bushes grew, with a sparse pasture area for the horses. They unsaddled the animals and took off the packs, hobbling the horses' forelegs so that they would stay close to the water and not go in search of grazing land farther away, where none existed. Then the men washed themselves, as prescribed by law, before prayers. At the first appearance of the bright crescent moon in the blue summer night sky, they said their prayers of mourning for the dead and of gratitude to God for sending them, in His unfathomable mercy, the worst of their foes to rescue them. They talked a bit about this very subject after prayers. Yusuf then said that he thought God, in an almost humorous way, had shown His omnipotence, revealing that nothing was impossible for Him, not even sending Templar knights to rescue the very ones who in the end would conquer all Templar knights. Yusuf tried to convince himself and everyone else of this. Year after year, new warlords arrived from the Frankish lands. If they won, they soon returned home with their heavy loads. But some Franks never went back home, and they were both the best and the worst of the lot. Best because they did not pillage for pleasure, and because it was possible to reason with them, making trade contracts and peace arrangements. But they were also the worst because some of them were fierce adversaries in war. The worst of them all were the two cursed, devout orders of competing monks, the Templars and the Hospitallers of St. John. Whoever wanted to cleanse the land of the enemy, whoever wanted to take back Al-Aqsa and the Temple of the Rock in God's holy city, would have to conquer both the Knights Templar and the Hospitallers. Nothing else was possible. Yet they seemed impossible to conquer. They fought without fear, convinced that they would enter paradise if they died in battle. They never surrendered since their laws forbade the rescue of captured brothers from imprisonment. A captured Hospitaller knight or Templar knight was a worthless prisoner that they might just as soon release or kill. So they always died. It was a rule of thumb that if 15 of the faithful met 5 Templar knights out on a plain, it meant that either all or none of them would live. If the 15 faithful attacked the 5 infidels, none of the faithful would escape with his life. To ensure victory of such an attack, they had to be 4 times as many and still be prepared to pay a very high price in casualties. With ordinary Franks, this was not the case. Ordinary Franks could be defeated even if there were fewer men on the side of the faithful. While Fakhra and Emir Musa gathered wood to make a fire, Yusuf lay on his back with his hands behind his head, staring up at the sky where more and more stars were appearing. He was pondering these men who were his worst enemies. He thought about what he had seen right before sundown. The man called Al-Guti had a horse worthy of a king, a horse that seemed to think the same thoughts as his master, that obeyed instinctively. It was not sorcery. Yusuf was a man who ultimately rejected such explanations. The simple truth was that the man and the horse had fought and trained together for many years, in the most serious fashion, not just as a pastime to be taken up when there was nothing else to do. Among the Egyptian Mamelukes there were similar men and horses, and the Mamelukes, of course, did nothing but train until they were successful enough to obtain commissions and land, their freedom and gold granted in gratitude for many good years of service in war. This was no miracle or magic. It was man alone and not God who created these kinds of men. The only question was, what was the most crucial characteristic for attaining that goal? Yusuf's answer to this question was always that it was pure faith, that the one who wholeheartedly and absolutely followed the words of the Prophet, may peace be with him, regarding the jihad, the holy war, would become an unconquerable warrior. But the problem was that among the Mamluks in Egypt it was impossible to find the most faithful of Muslims. Usually they were Turks and more or less superstitious, believing in spirits and holy stones and giving only lip service to the pure and true faith. In this case it was worse that even the infidels could create men like Al-Ghuti. Could it be that God was demonstrating that man uses his own free will to determine his purpose in life, in this life on earth, and that only when the holy fire separates the wheat from the chaff will it be apparent who are the faithful and who are the infidels? It was a disheartening thought, for if it was God's intention that the faithful, if they could unite in a jihad against the infidels, should be rewarded with victory, why then had he created enemies who were impossible to defeat man to man? Perhaps to show that the faithful truly had to unite against the enemy? The faithful had to stop fighting among themselves, because those who joined forces would be 10 to 100 times more numerous than the Franks, who would then be doomed even if they were all Templar knights. Yusuf again recalled the image of Al-Ghuti, his stallion, his black, well-oiled and undamaged harness, his equipment, none of which was merely for the pleasure of the eye, but for the joy of the hand. Something could be learned from this. Many men had died on the battlefield because they couldn't resist wearing their stiff new glittery gold brocade over their armor, which hindered their movements at the crucial moment, and thus they died more from vanity than anything else. Everything they had seen should be remembered and learned from. Otherwise, how were they going to conquer the devilish enemy that now occupied God's holy city? The fire had already begun to crackle. Fakhra and Emir Musa had spread out the muslin coverlet and were starting to set out provisions and drinking vessels of water. Emir Musa squatted down and ground up his mocha beans to prepare his black Bedouin drink. With the descending darkness, a cool breeze came racing down the mountainside from Al-Khalil, the city of Abraham. But the cool air after a hot day would soon give way to cold. The westerly direction of the wind brought Yusuf the scent of the two Franks at the same time as he heard them out in the darkness. It was the smell of slaves and battlefields. No doubt they would come unwashed to the evening meal, like the barbarians they were. When the Templar knight stepped into the light of the fire, the faithful saw that he was carrying his white shield with the red cross before him, as no guest ever should. Emir Musa took several hesitant steps toward his saddle where he had stacked up their weapons with the harnesses, but Yusuf quickly caught his nervous eye and quietly shook his head. The Templar knight bowed before each of his hosts in turn, and his sergeant followed his master's lead. Then he surprised the three faithful by lifting up his white shield with the loathsome cross and setting it as high up as he could in one of the low trees. When he then stepped forward to unfasten his sword and sit down, as Yusuf invited him to do with a gesture of his hand, the Templar knight explained that as far as he knew, there were no malicious men in the area, but you could never be certain. For that reason, the shield of a Templar knight would probably have a chilling effect on their fighting spirit. He generously offered to let his shield hang there overnight and come back to get it at dawn, when it would be time for all of them to move on. When the Templar knight and his sergeant sat down near the muslin coverlet and began setting out their own bundles, dates, mutton, bread, and something unclean were visible, Yusuf could no longer hold back the laughter he had tried so hard to suppress. All the others looked up at him in surprise, since none of them had noticed anything amusing. The two Templar knights frowned, suspecting that they might be the objects of Yusuf's merriment. He had to explain, saying that if there was one thing in the world he had never expected to have as night-time protection, it was in truth a shield with the worst emblem of the enemy, although on the other hand this confirmed what he had always believed, that God in his omnipotence truly was not averse to joking with his children, and at this he thought they could all laugh. Just then the Templar Knight discovered a piece of smoked meat among the items his sergeant was setting out, and he said something harsh in Frankish and pointed with his long, sharp dagger. Red-faced, the sergeant removed the meat while the Templar Knight apologized, shrugging his shoulders and saying that what was impure meat for one person in this world was good meat for another. The three faithful now understood that a piece of pork had been lying in the middle of the food, and thus the entire meal was unclean. But Yusuf quickly whispered a reminder about God's word in those cases when a man finds himself in need, when laws are not laws in the same way as when a man is in his own house, and they all had to be content with that. Yusuf blessed the food in the name of God the Merciful and Gracious, and the Templar Knight blessed the food in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and the Mother of God, and none of the five men showed any disdain for the beliefs of the others. They began offering each other food, and finally, at Yusuf's invitation, the Templar Knight accepted a piece of lamb baked in bread, slicing it in two with his grey, unadorned, extremely sharp dagger. He then handed half of it on the tip of his knife to his sergeant, who stuffed it into his mouth, hiding his distaste. They ate in silence for a while. The faithful had placed the lamb baked in bread along with chopped green pistachios baked in spun sugar and honey on their side of the muslin coverlet. On their own side, the infidels had dried mutton, dates, and dry white bread. "There is something I would like to ask you, Templar Knight," said Yusuf after a while. He spoke in a low, intent voice, the way his closest friends knew he always talked when he had been thinking for a long time and wanted to understand something important. "You are our host. We have accepted your invitation, and we will gladly answer your questions. But remember that our faith is the true faith, not yours," replied the Templar Knight, with an expression as if he were daring to joke about his own faith. "Doubtless you know what I think about that matter, Templar Knight, but here is my question. You rescued us, we who are your foes. I have already acknowledged that this is true, and I have thanked you. But now I want to know why you did it." "We did not rescue our foes," said the Templar Knight thoughtfully. "We have been after those six bandits for a long time. We've been following them at a distance for a week, waiting for the right moment. Our mission was to kill them, not to rescue you. But at the same time, God happened to hold a protective hand over you, and neither you nor I can explain why." "But you are the real Al-Ghouti himself," Yusuf persisted. "Yes, that is so," said the Templar Knight. "I am the one the unbelievers in their own language now call Al-Ghouti, but my name is Arndigotia, and my mission was to free the world of those six unworthy men, and I completed my mission. That is the whole of it." "But why should someone like you do such a thing? Aren't you also the emir of the Knights Templar in your fortress in Gaza, a man of rank? Why should such a man take on such a lowly mission, and a dangerous one at that, setting out for these inhospitable regions just to kill bandits?"
"Because that was how our order came into being long before I was even born," replied the Templar Knight. "From the beginning, when our troops had liberated God's sepulchre, our people had no protection when they went on a pilgrimage down to the River Jordan, and the site where Yahia, as you call him, once baptized the Lord Jesus Christ. And back then, pilgrims carried all their possessions with them, instead of leaving them in safe keeping with us as they do now. They were easy prey for bandits. Our order was created to protect them, Even today it is considered a mission of honor to offer protection to pilgrims and kill bandits. So it is not as you think, that this is a lowly mission we give to just anyone. On the contrary, it is the heart and soul of our order, a mission of honor, as I said, and God granted our prayers.
You are right, Yusuf concluded with a sigh. We should always protect pilgrims. How much easier life would be here in Palestine if we all did so. By the way, in which Frankish country is this Gotia located?
Not exactly in any Frankish country, replied the Templar Knight with an amused glint in his eye, as if all his solemnity had suddenly vanished. Gotia lies far north of the land of the Franks, at the ends of the earth. But what country do you come from? You don't speak Arabic as if you came from Mecca.
I was born in Baalbek, but all three of us are Kurds, replied Yusuf in surprise. This is my brother Fakra, and this is my friend Musa. Where did you learn to speak the language of the faithful? Men like you do not usually end up in long captivity, do they?
No, that is true, replied the Templar Knight. Men like me don't end up in prison at all, and I'm sure that you know why. But I have lived in Palestine for 10 years. I am not here to steal goods and then go home after half a year. Most of the men who work for the Knights Templar speak Arabic. My sergeant's name, by the way, is Armand de Gascogne. He's quite new here and doesn't understand much of what we're saying. That's why he is so silent. Not like your men, who don't dare speak until you give them permission.
Your eyes are sharp, murmured Yusuf, red-faced. I am the eldest. You can already see gray hairs in my beard. I am the one who administers the family's money. We are merchants on our way to an important meeting in Cairo, and I don't know what my brother and my friend would want to ask one of the enemy's knights. We are all peaceful men.
The Templar Knight gave Yusuf a searching glance, but said nothing for a while. He took his time eating some of the honey-drenched almonds. He paused and held up a piece of the delicacy to the firelight to examine it, concluding that these baked goods must have come from Aleppo. Then he pulled out his wineskin and took a drink without asking permission or offering an apology, and handed the skin to his sergeant. Afterward, he leaned back comfortably and drew his big, thick, white mantle around him, with its terrifying red cross, looking at Yusuf as if he were assessing his opponent in a game of backgammon, not as a foe, but as someone who must be evaluated.
My unknown friend and foe. What use do any of us have for falsehoods when we eat together in peace, and both have given our word not to harm each other? He said at last. He spoke very easily, with no rancor in his voice. You are a warrior, as I am. If God wills, we shall meet next time on the battlefield. Your clothes betray you, your horses betray you, just as your harnesses do, and your swords, which are leaning against the saddles over there. They are swords made in Damascus. None of them costs less than 500 dinars in gold. Your peace and mine will soon be over. The truce is about to be ended, and if you don't know this now, you will know it soon. Let us therefore enjoy this strange hour. It's not often that a man gets to know his enemy, but let us not lie to each other.
Yusuf was struck by an almost irresistible urge to tell the Templar Knight honestly who he was, but it was true that the truce would soon be ended, although it had not yet been felt on any battlefield. And their mutual oath not to harm each other, the reason they could sit and eat together at all, was valid only for this evening.
"You're right, Templar Knight," he said at last. "Inshallah, if God wills, we will some day meet on the battlefield. But I also think, as you do, that a man should get to know his enemies, and you seem to know many more of the faithful than we know of the infidels. I now give my men permission to speak to you."
Yusuf leaned back, also drawing his mantle closer around him, and signalled to his brother and Emir that they were allowed to speak. But they both hesitated, accustomed as they were to sitting an entire evening and just listening. Since neither of them made any attempt to speak, the Templar Knight leaned toward his sergeant and carried on a brief whispered conversation in Frankish.
"My sergeant wonders about one thing," he then explained. "Your weapons, your horses, and your clothes alone are worth more than those unfortunate bandits could ever have dreamed of. How did it happen that you chose this perilous road west of the Dead Sea without sufficient escort?"
"Because it is the quickest route, because an escort arouses a great deal of attention," replied Yusuf slowly. He did not want to embarrass himself by again saying something that wasn't true, so he had to weigh his words. Any escort of his would certainly have attracted attention, because it would have consisted of at least 3,000 horsemen to be considered safe. "And because we trusted our horses. We didn't think a few worthless bandits or Franks would be able to catch us," he added swiftly.
"Wise, but not wise enough," the Templar Knight nodded. "But those 6 bandits have been plundering these regions for almost 30 years. They knew the area like the back of their hands. They could ride faster on these stretches than any of us could. That was what made them rich, until God punished them."
"I would like to know one thing," said Fakhra, who now spoke for the first time and had to clear his throat because he was stumbling over his own words. "It is said that you Templar Knights who reside in Al-Aqsa have a minbar there, a place of prayer for the faithful. And people have also told me that you Templar Knights once struck a Frank who tried to prevent one of the faithful from praying. Is this really true?"
All 3 of the faithful now gave their full attention to the enemy, but the Templar Knight smiled and first translated the question into Frankish for the sergeant, who at once nodded and burst out laughing.
"Yes, there is more truth to that than you know," said the Templar Knight, after thinking for a moment, or pretending to think in order to spur his listener's interest. "We do have a minbar in Templum Salomonis, as we call Al-Aqsa, the most remote of prayer sites. But that is not so unusual. In our fortress in Gaza, we have a majlis every Thursday, the only day possible, and the witnesses then swear on God's holy scriptures, on the Torah, or on the Quran, and in some cases on something else entirely that they regard as holy. If the 3 of you were Egyptian merchants, as you claimed, you would also know that our order conducts a great deal of business with the Egyptians, and they do not share our beliefs. Al-Aqsa, if you wish to use that name, is where we Templar Knights have our headquarters, and where many people come as our guests. The problem is that every September new vessels arrive from Pisa or Genoa or the southern lands of the Franks, with new men filled with the spirit and the zeal, perhaps not to enter paradise at once, but to kill unbelievers, or at least lay hands on them. These newcomers create great difficulties for the rest of us, and each year, shortly after September,
We always have disturbances in our own quarters, because the newcomers turn against people of your faith, and then, of course, we have to deal with them harshly.
You would kill your own kind for the sake of our people? Gasped Fakra.
Of course not, replied the Templar Knight with sudden vehemence. For us it is a grave sin, just as it is in your faith, to kill any man who is a true believer. That can never come into question. He went on after a brief pause, his good humor restored. But nothing prevents us from giving rogues like that a good thrashing, if they refuse to be persuaded. I myself have had the pleasure on several occasions. Quickly he leaned toward his sergeant and translated. When the sergeant began nodding and laughing in agreement, a great sense of relief seemed to come over everyone, and they all joined in with hearty laughter, perhaps a bit too hearty. A gust of air, like the last sigh of the evening wind from the mountains near Al-Khalil, suddenly carried the stench of the Templar Knights toward the three faithful, and they shrank back, unable to hide their feelings. The Templar Knight noticed their embarrassment and rose to his feet immediately, suggesting that they change sides and wind direction around the muslin coverlet where Emir Musa was now setting up small cups of mocha. The three hosts complied with his suggestion at once without saying anything offensive. We have our rules, explained the Templar Knight apologetically as he settled into his new place. You have rules about washing yourselves at all times of the day, and we have rules that forbid doing so. It is no worse than the fact that you have rules permitting hunting, while we have ones forbidding it, except for lions. Or that we drink wine and you do not.
Wine is a different matter, objected Yusuf. The prohibition against wine is a strict one, and it is God's word to the prophet, may peace be with him. But we are not like our enemies. Just consider God's words in the seventh surah.
Who has forbidden the beautiful things that God has granted his servants and all the good he has given them for their sustenance?
Well, yes, said the Templar Knight, your scriptures say many things. But if, for the sake of vanity, you want me to expose my modesty and make myself fair-smelling like worldly men, I might just as well ask you to stop calling me your enemy. For just listen to the words of your own scriptures from the 61st surah, words of your own prophet, may peace be with him. Faithful, be God's disciples, just as Jesus, the Son of Mary, said to the white-clad, Who will be my disciple for the sake of God? And they answered, We will be God's disciples. Among the children of Israel, some came to believe in Jesus, while others rejected him. But we supported those who believed in him against their enemies, and the faithful departed with victory. I particularly liked the part about the white clad. At these words, Emir Musa sprang to his feet as if he were about to reach for his sword, but halfway there he restrained himself and stopped. His face was red with anger when he stretched out his arm and pointed an accusatory finger at the Templar Knight.
Infidel! He cried. You speak the language of the Quran. That is one thing. But twisting God's words with blasphemy and ridicule is another matter that you would not be allowed to survive if it weren't for His Majesty. Because my friend Yusuf has given you his word. Sit down and behave yourself, Musa! Shouted Yusuf harshly, regaining his composure as Musa obeyed his command. What you heard were indeed the words of God, and they were from the 61st surah, and they are words you ought to consider. And don't think, by the way, that the phrase the white-robed refers to what our guest spoke of in jest.
No, of course it does not, the Templar Knight hurried to smooth things over. It refers to those who wore white robes long before my order existed. My clothing has nothing to do with it. "How do you happen to be so familiar with the Quran?" asked Yusuf in his customary and quiet, calm tone of voice, as if no disruption had occurred, and his high rank had not been almost revealed. "It is a wise thing to study your enemy. If you like, I can help you to understand the Bible," replied the Templar Knight, as if trying to joke his way out of the topic, seeming to regret his clumsy invasion of the faithful's territory. Yusuf was about to utter a stern reply to his light-hearted talk of entering into blasphemous studies when he was interrupted by a long, drawn-out, horrifying scream. The scream turned into something that sounded like scornful laughter, rolling down toward them and echoing off the mountainsides above. All five men froze and listened. Emir Musa immediately began rattling off the words the faithful used to conjure up the genie of the desert. Then the scream came again, but now it sounded as if it came from several spirits of the abyss, as if they were talking to each other, as if they had discovered the little fire below and the only people in the area. The Templar Knight leaned forward and whispered a few words in Frankish to his sergeant, who nodded at once, stood up, and buckled on his sword. He drew his black mantle tighter, bowed to his unbeliever hosts, and then, without saying a word, turned on his heel and disappeared into the darkness. "You must excuse this rudeness," said the Templar Knight, "but the fact is that we have the scent of blood and fresh meat up in our camp, and horses that must be tended to." He didn't seem to think he needed to offer any further explanation, and with a bow he stretched out his mocha cup for Emir Musa to refill it. The emir's hand shook slightly as he poured.
"You send your sergeant into the darkness, and he obeys without blinking?" said Fakhra in a voice that sounded slightly hoarse.
"Yes," said the Templar Knight. "A man must obey, even if he feels fear. But I don't think that Armand does. The darkness is more of a friend for the man who wears a black mantle than the one who wears white, and Armand's sword is sharp and his hand steady. Wild dogs, those spotted beasts with their horrid barking, are also known for their cowardice, are they not?"
"But are you certain it was only wild dogs we heard?" asked Fakhra doubtfully.
"No," replied the Templar Knight. "There is much we do not know between heaven and hell. No one can ever be certain. But the Lord is our shepherd, and we shall not want, even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. That is doubtless what Armand is praying as he walks along in the dark right now. That is what I would pray, at any rate. If God has measured out our time and wishes to call us home, there is nothing we can do, of course. But until then we cleave the skulls of wild dogs as we do those of our enemies, and in that respect I know that you who believe in the Prophet, may peace be with him, and deny the Son of God, think exactly as we do. Am I not right, Yusuf?"
"You are right, Templar Knight," Yusuf confirmed. "But then where is the borderline between reason and belief, between fear of and trust in God? If a man must obey as your sergeant must obey, does that make his fear any less?"
"When I was young, well, I am not yet a particularly old man," said the Templar Knight, seeming to think deeply, "I was still preoccupied with that sort of question. It is good for your mind. Your thoughts grow nimble from exercising your mind. But nowadays I am afraid I grow sluggish. You obey, you conquer evil. Afterward, you thank God. That is all."
"And if you do not conquer your enemy?" asked Yusuf
in a gentle voice, which those who knew him did not recognize as his normal voice.
"Then you die, at least in the case of Armand and myself," replied the Templar Knight.
"And on Judgment Day you and I will be measured and weighed. And where you will then end up, I cannot say. even though I know what you yourself believe. But if I die here in Palestine, my place will be in paradise."
"You truly believe that?"
asked Yusuf in his strange, gentle voice.
"Yes, I believe that," replied the Templar Knight.
"Then tell me one thing. Is that promise actually in your Bible?"
"No, not exactly. It does not say that exactly."
"But you are still quite certain?"
"Yes, the Holy Father in Rome has promised."
"But he is only a man. What man can promise you a place in paradise, Templar Knight?"
"But Mohammed too was merely a man, and you believe in his promise, forgive me, may peace be to his name."
"Mohammed, may peace be with him, was God's messenger, and God said, 'But the messenger and those who follow him in faith and strive for the sake of God, offering up their property and lives, shall be rewarded with goodness in this life and in the next, and everything they touch will prosper.' Those words are very clear, are they not? And it goes on."
"Yes, in the next verse of the ninth surah," the Templar Knight interjected brusquely, "God has prepared for them gardens of pleasure, watered by streams, where they shall remain for all eternity. This is the great and glorious victory."
"So, we understand each other, I presume. None of this is foreign to you, Yusuf. And by the way, the difference between us is that I have no possessions. I have put myself in God's hands. And when he decides, I will die for his sake. Your own beliefs do not contradict what I say."
"Your knowledge of God's word is truly great, Templar Knight," said Yusuf.
But at the same time he was pleased that he had caught his enemy in a trap, and his companions could see this.
"Yes, as I said, you should know your enemy," said the Templar Knight, for the first time a little uncertain, as if he too realized that Yusuf had backed him into a corner.
"But if you speak in this way, you are not my enemy," said Yusuf. "You quote from the Holy Quran, which is God's word. What you say does apply to me, but not to you for the time being. For the faithful, all of this is as clear as water, but what is it for you?"
"In truth, I know as much about Jesus as you know about the prophet, may peace be with him.
But what did Jesus say about the holy war? Did Jesus speak a single word about you entering paradise if you killed me?"
"Let us not quarrel about this," said the Templar Knight with a confident wave of his hand, as if everything had suddenly become petty, although they could all see his uncertainty. "Our beliefs are not the same, even though they have many similarities, but we have to live in the same land, fighting each other in the worst case, making treaties and conducting business in the best case. Now let us speak of other matters. It is my wish as your guest."
They were all aware how Yusuf had driven his opponent into a corner where he had no more defences.
Jesus had clearly never said anything about it being pleasing to God to kill Saracens. But when pressed harder, the Templar Knight had still managed to wriggle out of the difficult situation by referring to the faithful's own unwritten laws of hospitality. And so his wish had to be granted. He was the guest, after all.
"In truth, you do know a great deal about your enemy, Templar Knight," said Yusuf.
Both his voice and expression showed that he was very pleased at having won the discussion.
"As we agreed, it is necessary to know your enemy," replied the Templar Knight in a low voice, his eyes downcast.
They sat in silence for a while, gazing into their mocha cups, since it seemed difficult to start up the conversation in a natural way after Yusuf's victory. But then the silence was again shattered by the sound of beasts. This time they all knew it was animals and not some devilish creature.
and it sounded as if they were attacking someone or something, and then as if they were fleeing with howls of pain and death.
"Armand's sword is sharp, as I said," murmured the Templar Knight.
"Why in the name of peace did you take your corpses with you?" asked Fakra, who was thinking the same thing as his brothers of the faith.
"Of course it would have been better to take them alive. Then they would not have smelled so foul on the way home, and they could have travelled with ease. But tomorrow it will be a hot day. We must start our journey early to get them to Jerusalem before they begin to stink too much," replied the Templar Knight.
"But if you had taken them prisoner, if you had taken them alive to Al-Quds, what would have happened to them then?" persisted Fakra.
"We would have turned them over to our emir in Jerusalem, who is one of the highest ranking in our order. He would have turned them over to the worldly powers, and they would have been disrobed, except for that which covers their modesty, and hung up on the wall by the rock," replied the Templar Knight, as if it were quite obvious.
"But you have already killed them. Why not disrobe them here and leave them to the fate they deserve? Why do you defend their bodies against the wild animals?" asked Fakra, as if he did not want to give up or did not understand.
"We will still hang them there," replied the Templar Knight. "Everyone must see that whoever robs pilgrims will end up hanging there. That is a holy promise from our order, and it must always be kept as long as God helps us."
"But what will you do with their weapons and clothes?" wondered Emir Musa, speaking as if he wanted to bring the conversation down to a more practical level.
"Surely they must have had quite a few valuables on them."
"Yes, but they are all stolen goods," replied the Templar Knight, some of his old self-assurance back. "Except for their weapons and armor, for which we have no use. But their thieves' cache is in a grotto up where Armand and I have our camp. We will take heavily laden horses home with us tomorrow. Keep in mind that those beasts have been plundering here for more than half a year."
"But you are not allowed to own anything," objected Yusuf mildly, raising his right eyebrow, as if he thought that he had once again won the argument.
"No, I am not allowed to own anything," exclaimed the Templar Knight in surprise. "If you think we would take the thieves' treasures for our own, you are greatly mistaken. We will place all the stolen goods outside the Church of the Holy Sepulchre next Sunday, and if those who have been robbed can find their possessions, they can have them back."
"But surely most of those who were robbed are now dead," said Yusuf quietly.
"They may have heirs who are alive, but whatever is not claimed will be donated to our order," replied the Templar Knight.
"That is a most interesting explanation for what I have heard, that you consider yourselves too good to plunder a battlefield," said Yusuf with a smile, seeming to think he had won another exchange of words.
"No, we do not take plunder from battlefields," replied the Templar Knight coldly. "But that should not present a problem, since there are so many others who do. If we have taken part in a victory, we turn at once toward God. If you would like to hear what your own Quran has to say about plundering a battlefield—"
"Thank you, no," Yusuf interrupted him, holding up a hand in warning. "We would prefer not to return to a topic of conversation, since it would seem that you, an infidel, know more than we do about the word of the Prophet, may peace be with him. Let me instead ask you a very candid question."
"Yes, ask me a candid question, and it shall be given the answer it deserves," replied the Templar Knight, holding up his hands palm out to show, in the manner of the faithful, that he agreed to change the topic of conversation.
"You said that the truce between us would soon be over. Is it Bryn's Arnat you are referring to?"
You know a great deal, Yusuf. Brins Arnat, whom we call Renaud du Châtillon, has been plundering again. And, by the way, he is no prince, but an evil man who is unfortunately allied with the Knights Templar. This I know, and I regret. I would rather not be his ally, but I obey orders. But no, he is not the major problem.
Then it must be something about that new prince who came from the land of the Franks with a great army. What is it he is called? Philus something or other?
No, said the Templar Knight with a smile. He is indeed Philus, meaning the son of someone. His name is Philip of Flanders. He is a duke, and yes, he came with a great army. But now I must warn you before we continue this conversation.
Why is that? Asked Yusuf, feigning nonchalance. I have your word. Have you ever broken a vow you have sworn?
I once made a vow that I have not yet been able to fulfill. It will take 10 years before I can do so, if it is God's will. But I have never broken a promise, and may God help me, I never will.
Well then, why should our truce be broken because of the arrival of someone named Philus from some Flamson? Surely such things happen all the time.
The Templar Knight gave Yusuf a long, searching look, but Yusuf did not avert his eyes. This went on for some time. Both refused to give in. You wish to keep secret your identity, said the Templar Knight at last, without taking his eyes off Yusuf. But few men could know so much about what goes on in the world of war, certainly not someone who claims to be a merchant on his way to Cairo. If you insist on speaking more about this, I can no longer pretend that I do not know who you are. A man who has spies, a man who knows. There are not many such men.
You have my word also. Remember that, Templar Knight.
Of all the unbelievers, your word is no doubt the one most of us would trust most.
You honor me with your words. So why will our truce be broken?
Ask your men to leave us if you will continue this conversation, Yusuf.
Yusuf pondered this for a moment as he pensively tugged on his beard. If the Templar Knight truly understood who he was talking to, would it then be easier for him to kill and at the same time break his word? No, that was unlikely. Considering how this man had behaved when he killed earlier in the evening, he had no need to make it easier to betray his vow. He would have drawn his sword long ago. Yet it was difficult to understand his demand, which seemed unreasonable. At the same time, no one would particularly benefit if it were met. In the end, Yusuf's curiosity won out over his caution.
Leave us, he commanded curtly. Go to sleep close by. You can clean up here in the morning. Remember that we are in the field, under camp rules. Fakhra and Emir Musa hesitated. They started to get to their feet as they looked at Yusuf, but his stern glance made them obey. They bowed to the Templar Knight and withdrew. Yusuf waited in silence until his brother and his closest bodyguard had moved far enough away and could be heard arranging their bedding. I don't think my brother and Musa will have an easy time falling asleep.
No, said the Templar Knight, but neither will they be able to hear what we say.
Why is it so important for them not to hear what we say?
It is not important, said the Templar Knight, smiling. What is important is that you know they won't hear what you say. Then our conversation will be more candid.
For a man who lives in a monastery, you know a great deal about human nature.
In the monastery, we learn much about human nature, more than you imagine. Now, to what is more important. I will speak only of things that I am positive you already know, since anything else would be treason. But let us examine the situation. As you know, a new Frankish prince is coming. He will remain here for some time. He has everyone's blessing back home for his holy mandate in God's service and so on. He has brought a great army along with him. So what will he do?
Acquire riches as fast as possible, since he has had great expenses.
Precisely, Yusuf, precisely. But will he go against Saladin himself and Damascus?
No, then he would risk losing everything.
Precisely, Yusuf. We understand each other completely, and we can speak freely, now that your subordinates are out of earshot. So where will the new plunderer and his army go?
Toward a city that is sufficiently strong and sufficiently wealthy, but I do not know which one.
Precisely. Nor do I know which one.
Homs, Hama, perhaps Aleppo.
No, too far away and too strong a city. Let us say Homs or Hama as the most obvious. What will our worldly Christian king in Jerusalem and the royal army do then?
They do not have much choice. They will join in with the plundering, even though they would rather use the new forces to attack Saladin.
Precisely, Yusuf. You know everything. You understand everything. So now we both know what the situation is. What do we do about it?
To begin with, you and I will both keep our word.
Of course, that goes without saying. But what else do we do?
We use this time of peace between us to understand each other better. I may never have the chance to talk to a Templar Knight again. You may never have the chance to talk to an enemy, such as myself.
No, you and I will probably meet only on this one occasion in our lives.
The singular whim of God. But then let me ask you, Templar Knight, what is needed more than God if we, the faithful, are to vanquish you?
Two things. What Saladin is now doing, uniting all Saracens against us,
that is already taking place. But the other thing is treason among those of us on the side of Jesus Christ, betrayal or grave sins, for which God will punish us. But if not betrayal or these grave sins,
then neither of us will ever win, Yusuf. The difference between us is that you Saracens can lose one battle after another. You mourn your dead, and you soon have a new army on the march. We Christians can lose only a great battle, and we are not that foolish. If we have the advantage, we attack. If we are at a disadvantage, we seek refuge in our fortresses. It can go on in this fashion forever.
So our war will last forever?
Perhaps. Perhaps not. Some of us. Do you know who Count Raymond de Tripoli is?
Yes, I know. Know of him. And?
If Christians like him should win power in the kingdom of Jerusalem, and you have on your side a leader like Saladin, then there can be peace, a just peace. In any case, something better than eternal war.
Many of us Templar Knights think as Count Raymond does. But to return to our previous topic concerning what is going to happen right now, the Hospitallers followed the royal army and the prince up to Syria. We Templar Knights did not.
I already know that.
Yes, doubtless you know this, because your name is Yusuf ibn
Ayub Salah al-Din, the one we call Saladin in our language. May God be merciful to us now that you know this. God is merciful to us by granting us this strange conversation during the last hours of peace between us. And we will both keep our word. You surprise me with your uneasiness about that point. You are the only one of our enemies who is known for always keeping his word. I am a Templar Knight. We always keep our word. Enough said about that matter.
Yes, enough about that matter. But now, my dear enemy, at this late hour, before a dawn when we both have urgent errands, you with your foul-smelling corpses and I with something else that I will not discuss, but which you certainly can imagine, what do we do now?
We take advantage of this only opportunity that God may give us in life, to speak sensibly with the worst of all enemies. There is one thing that you and I can agree on. Forgive me if I address you so plainly now that I know you are the Sultan of both Cairo and Damascus.
No one but God hears us, as you so wisely arranged. I wish for you to use the informal means of address on this one night.
We agreed on one thing, I think. We are risking eternal war, because neither side can win.
True, but I will win. I have sworn to win.
As have I.
Eternal war, then? That does not sound promising for the future.
Then we will continue. Even though I am merely a simple emir among the Knights Templar, and you are the only one of our foes in a long time that we have had reason to fear, where should we begin now?
They began with the question of the pilgrim's safety. That was the most obvious. That was the reason they had met in the first place, if they sought a human explanation for it and did not look solely to God's will in all things. But even though they both firmly believed, at least when they spoke aloud, that God's will guided everything, neither of them was a stranger to the idea that man, with his free will, could also bring about great calamities, as well as great happiness. This was a cornerstone in both of their faiths. They talked for a long time that night. At dawn, when Fakhra found his older brother, the glorious prince, the light of religion, the commander of the faithful in the holy war, the water in the desert, the sultan of Egypt and Syria, the hope of the faithful, the man whom the infidels for all time would call by the simple name Saladin. He was sitting with his chin resting on his knees, huddled under his cloak, which was wrapped around him, and staring into the dying embers. The white shield with the evil red cross was gone, as was the Templar Knight. Saladin wearily looked up at his brother, almost as if he had awakened from a dream.
If all our foes were like Al-Ghuti, we would never win, he said thoughtfully. On the other hand, if all our foes were like him, victory would no longer be necessary.
Fakhra did not understand what his brother and prince meant, but supposed it was mostly meaningless weary mutterings, as had happened so many times before when Yusuf stayed up too long and brooded.
We must head out. We have a hard ride to Al-Arish, said Saladin, getting stiffly to his feet. War awaits, and we will soon be victorious.
It was true that war awaited. That was as written. But it was also written that Saladin and Arn Magnusson de Gotia would soon meet again on the battlefield, and that only one of them would come away victorious.
Chapter 2. Jerusalem was located in the middle of a world from which even Rome seemed a distant place. Farther away was the kingdom of the Franks, and almost at the ends of the earth in the cold, dark north lay the land of Western Jutland, which was known to very few. It was said among learned men that beyond was nothing but dark forest stretching to the edge of the earth, inhabited by monsters with two heads. Nevertheless, the true faith had reached up here to the cold and the dark, mostly thanks to Saint Bernard, who, in his mercy and love of humankind, had found that even the barbarians up in the dark north had a right to salvation of the soul. It was he who sent the first monks to the wild, unknown land of the Goths. Soon the light and truth had spread from more than 10 cloisters among the Northmen, who were now no longer lost. A convent located in the southern part of Western Jutland had the loveliest of all cloister names. It was called Goodhem, God's Home, and it was dedicated to the Virgin Mary. The convent stood atop a hill, and from there could be seen the distant blue mountain, Billingen, and if a person strained his eyes a bit, he might see the two towers of the cathedral in Skara. North of Goodhem glittered Hornboria Lake, where the cranes appeared in the spring before the pike began to play. Surrounding the cloister were farms and fields and small groves of oak. It was a very peaceful and beautiful landscape, and did not at all lead the mind to thoughts of darkness and barbarity. For the older woman who had made a substantial donation and travelled here to conclude her life in peace, the name of Goodhem sounded like a caress, and the region was the loveliest that an ageing eye could meet. But for Cecilia Algot's daughter, who had been locked up at Goodhem at the age of 17 because of her sins, the convent for a long time seemed a home without God, a place that was considered more of a hell on earth. Cecilia was familiar with cloister life, and that was not what frightened her. She also knew Goodhem, because at various intervals in her life she had spent more than 2 years inside among the novices, young women who were sent to the convent by wealthy families to be disciplined and taught good manners before they were married off. She already knew how to read, she knew the Book of Psalms by heart, and the words tumbled from her lips like running water, because she had sung every psalm more than 100 times. So in this there was nothing new and nothing frightening. But this time she had been consigned to convent life, and the sentence was harsh, 20 years. She had been sentenced, together with her betrothed, Arn Magnusson of the Folkung clan, because they had committed a grave sin when they united in carnal love before being married before God. It was Cecilia's sister, Katerina, who had reported them, and the proof of their sin was such that no argument would avail. The day that the convent gate closed behind Cecilia, she was already in her 3rd month. Her betrothed Arn had also been sentenced to 20 years, but he was to serve his time as a monk in God's holy army in the far reaches of the Holy Land. Over the portal of Goodhem Convent there were 2 sandstone sculptures depicting Adam and Eve, driven out of paradise after the fall, hiding their shame with fig leaves. The image was meant to be a warning, and it spoke directly to Cecilia, as if it had been cut and chiseled and polished out of stone expressly for her sake. She had been separated from her beloved Arn only a stone's throw from this portal. He had fallen to his knees and sworn with the passion that only a 17-year-old youth can swear, and even upon his sword that was blessed by God. He vowed to endure all fire and war, and promised to come back and fetch her when their penance was paid. That was a long time ago now, and from Arn in the Holy Land she had heard not a word. But what frightened Cecilia from the very start, when Abbess Rikisa dragged her in through the gate with a hard and undignified grip round her wrist, as if leading a thrall to her punishment, was that Goodham had now become an utterly different place. It was not the same as when she had previously spent time here with the novices. That is, on the surface, Goodham was still the place she knew, and only a few new outbuildings had been added. But inside, much was changed, and she truly had good reason to feel fear. The land for Goodham had been donated from the royal holdings by King Karl Sverkason. Consequently, the Abbess Rikisa belonged to the Sverka clan, as did most of the consecrated sisters and almost all the novices. But when the pretender to the throne, Knut Eriksson, the son of Saint Erik Jedvarsson, returned from his exile in Norway to reclaim his father's crown and avenge his murder, he himself had murdered King Karl Sverkason out on the island of Visingsö. And among the men who abetted him in this deed was his friend and Cecilia's lover, Arne Magnusson. So in the world outside the cloister walls, war now raged anew. On one side were the Falkon clan and the Erik clan with their Norwegian allies. On the other were the Sverka clan and their Danish allies. Cecilia thus felt like a butterfly dragged into a hornet's nest, and she had good reason to feel this way. Since most of the sisters belonged to the Sverka faction, they hated her, and they showed it. All the novices hated her as well, and did nothing to hide their animosity. No one spoke to Cecilia, even when talking was permitted. They all turned their backs on her. In the early days, it was possible that Mother Rikisa had actually tried to drive her to her death. Cecilia had come to Goodham in the months when the turnips had to be thinned. It was hard, hot work out in the fields, and none of the elegant sisters or the novices took part. Mother Rikisa had put Cecilia on bread and water from the very first day. At mealtimes in the refectorium, Cecilia was seated alone at an empty table at the far end of the hall, where she had to sit silently. As if this were not punishment enough, Mother Rikisa had decreed that Cecilia had to work with the lay sisters out in the turnip fields, crawling along bit by bit with the baby kicking in her belly. As if that wasn't bad enough, or perhaps because Mother Rikisa was cross that Cecilia hadn't lost her child from the hard labour, the young woman was sent for bloodletting once a week during her first and hardest time at the convent. It was said that bloodletting was good for one's health, and that it also had a salutary effect that suppressed carnal desires, and since Cecilia had obviously fallen prey to such desires, she should have her blood let often. As Cecilia crawled along in the turnip fields, growing ever paler, she constantly murmured prayers to Our Lady to protect her, forgive her for her sin, and yet hold her gracious hand over the child she bore inside her. Cecilia almost gave birth to her son out in the cold November mud in the turnip fields. It was near the end of the harvest time when she suddenly sank to the ground with a sharp cry. The lay sisters and the two supervisors who stood nearby to monitor virtue and silence during the work understood at once what was about to happen. At first they acted as if they thought nothing needed to be done, but the lay sisters would not stand for this. Without uttering a word, even to ask permission, they hurried to carry Cecilia to the hospitium, the guest house outside the walls. There they laid her in bed and sent a messenger to fetch Fru Helena, who was a wise woman and one of Goodham's pensioners who had given a large donation to the convent. Fru Helena came quickly, taking pity on Cecilia, although she herself was of the Sverka clan.
She ordered two of the lay sisters to stay in the hospitium and assist her. Let Rikisa, she didn't say Mother Rikisa, think or say what she would. Women had a hard enough time in this world without heaping stones on one another's burdens, she told the two astonished lay sisters who stayed with her. At her command, they heated water, fetched linens, and washed the mud and dirt from the suffering Cecilia, now almost out of her mind with pain. Fru Helena had come to her rescue, and she must have been sent by the Holy Virgin herself. She had given birth to 9 children, 7 of whom had survived. Many times she had assisted other women in this difficult hour, when women are alone and only other women can help. She scoffed at the thought that this young woman was supposed to be her enemy. She told the two lay sisters that the position of friend or foe could change overnight, or even as a result of a sorry little war between the menfolk. Cecilia did not remember much of the hours that night when she gave birth to her son, Magnus, as they had decided he should be named. She remembered the moment when it was all over, and drenched in sweat and hot, as if with fever, she was given the infant by Fru Helena, who pressed him to her aching breasts. And she recalled Fru Helena's words that he was a fair boy in good health with all his limbs in the proper place. But after that, a haze shrouded her mind. Later, she learned that Fru Helena had sent word to Arnes, and a large escort came to fetch the babe and take him to safety. Birja Brosa, the mightiest of the Folkungs, and the uncle of her beloved Arn, had sworn that the lad, he had never spoken of the anticipated child as other than the lad, would be taken into the clan and proclaimed at the Ting as a true Folkung, whether he was born in whoredom or not. Of all the trials in young Cecilia's life, the hardest of all was that she would not see her son again until he was a man. Mother Rikisa had a heart of stone where Cecilia was concerned. Shortly after giving birth, Cecilia was once again set to hard labor, although she still had a fever. She was often bathed in sweat, she was very pale, and she had trouble with her breasts. As Christmas approached in her first year at the cloister, Bishop Bengt came from Skara on visitation, and when he noticed Cecilia shuffling past out in the arcade, seemingly oblivious to everything, he blanched. Then he had a brief conversation with Mother Rikisa in private. That same day, Cecilia was placed in the infirmatorium, and she was given daily pittances, extra helpings of food that those outside were allowed to donate to the residents of the cloister, eggs, fish, white bread, butter, and even some lamb. Gossip spread at Goodhem about these pittances that Cecilia received. Some believed that they came from Bishop Bengt, others that they came from Fru Helena, or perhaps from Birja Brosa himself. She was also excused from bloodletting, and soon the colour returned to her face, and she started to regain her health. But all hope seemed to have left her. She went about mostly muttering to herself. When winter swept into western Jutland with cold and ice, all outside work ceased for both the lay sisters and Cecilia. This was a relief. Yet at the same time the nights became an even greater torment. Since it was against the rules to have heating in the dormitorium, it was important where in the room one's bed stood. The farther away from the two windows, the better. Naturally, Cecilia was assigned the bed right next to the stone wall, beneath a window where the cold came flowing down like ice water. The other novices slept on the other side of the room, against the internal wall. Cecilia and her worldly sisters were separated by the 8 lay sisters, who never dared to speak to her. The regulations permitted a straw mattress, a pillow, and 2 woolen blankets. Even if they all went to bed fully dressed, the nights could sometimes get so cold that it was impossible to sleep, at least for someone who always shook with cold. It was at this most difficult time at Goodhem for Cecilia that it seemed as though Our Lady sent her some consolation, a few words that would not have meant very much to anyone else, but here warmed her to the heart. One of the other maidens close to the door had been found unworthy of the best bed location when someone revealed one of her secrets. On Mother Rikis's express order, she was forced to move to the bed next to Cecilia's. One evening, she came with her bedclothes in her arms and stood with bowed head, waiting until the lay sister in the bed next to Cecilia grasped that she was supposed to toddle off to the warmer side of the room. When the lay sister had taken her bedclothes and gone, the new maiden slowly and carefully made her bed, glancing over at the sister who stood in the dark by the door to the stairs and kept a watchful eye on the proceedings. When she was done, the maiden crept into bed, turned on her side, and sought out Cecilia's gaze. Then, without blinking, she broke the rule of silence.
"You're not alone, Cecilia," she whispered, so quietly that no one else could hear. "Thank you. Our Lady be praised," Cecilia signalled back, in the sign language they used at Goodhem when no words could be spoken. But she no longer felt cold, and her thoughts were directed to different matters, something other than the loneliness and unhappy longing in which she'd been circling for so long that sometimes she feared for her sanity. Now she lay for a while looking with curiosity into the eyes of her unknown companion who had spoken so kindly to her, even when it was forbidden to speak. They smiled at each other until the darkness came, and that night Cecilia did not shiver from the cold, and she quickly fell asleep. When they were awakened to go down to matins, she was sleeping deeply, and the unknown maiden next to her had to give her a gentle shake. Later, down in the church, Cecilia sang along in the hymns for the first time in full voice, her clear tones rising higher than all the others. Singing had, after all, been her one great joy in past years at Goodhem, back when she knew that she would be released after only a few months. And she fell asleep easily after matins, so when it was time for Lourdes, the morning praise song, the stranger had to wake her again. It seemed she had a need to catch up on lost sleep. After the first mass of the day, when it was time to gather in the chapter hall, Cecilia found that her new neighbour had to sit close to the door, just as she did, and again she contemplated the words that she was no longer alone, that now they were two. After Mother Rikisa read the day's Bible text, she recited a list of names of deceased brothers and sisters in the Cistercian order for whose souls they must pray. Cecilia froze briefly, for sometimes the list included a foreign name or the name of a fallen Templar knight who was counted as equal to brothers or sisters. But today there was no such name. The punishments were saved till last during the morning convocation. The most common infraction punished by Mother Rikisa was breach of the code of silence. 6 or 7 times Cecilia had been punished for this, despite the fact that no one ever spoke to Cecilia, nor did she speak to anyone else. "It so happened," explained Mother Rikisa, with something that looked more like a smile than an expression of sternness, "that it was now time to punish Cecilia again." The sisters then lowered their heads with a sigh, while the worldly maidens raised theirs and stared with inquisitive malice at Cecilia. However, it was not the usual Cecilia who was to be punished, not Cecilia Algot's daughter, but Cecilia Ulf's daughter. And now that there were two Cecilias who apparently displayed the same breach of conduct, the red-haired Cecilia Algot's daughter would hereafter be called Cecilia Rosa, and the blonde one would be called Cecilia Blanca.
The punishment was usually a day or two on bread and water, a common penalty meted out during the period when Mother Rikisa had seemed intent on tormenting Cecilia to death after her childbirth. But now Mother Rikisa ordered, more with scorn than with the grace of God, that Cecilia Blanca be led to the lapis culparum, the punishment stone, at the far end of the room. The prioress and one of the sisters promptly went over to Cecilia Blanca and took her by both arms to lead her to the punishment stone, where they removed her woolen mantle so that she stood there in only her linen shift. They stretched her hands above her head and fastened them with two handcuffs of iron. Then Mother Rikisa fetched a scourge and took up position next to the bound Cecilia Blanca and looked at her congregation, again showing more triumph than divine benevolence. She paused for a moment, testing the scourge by slapping it against her hand. Then she signalled for them to say three paternosters, and they all bowed their heads obediently and began reciting. When the prayers were concluded, she summoned one of the worldly maidens, Helena Sverka's daughter, handed her the scourge, and asked her, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Virgin, to administer three lashes. Helena Sverka's daughter was a clumsy, bumbling girl who seldom got the chance to stand out from the crowd. Now she looked at the other sisters with delight, and they all nodded at her in encouragement. Someone signaled for her to give Cecilia Blanca a good thrashing, and so she did. She did not do it in the usual way, which was intended to mark the memory and alter the mind, rather than to cause injury to the body. She struck as hard as she could, and with the last blow, two lines of blood seeped through Cecilia Blanca's white shift. Cecilia Blanca moaned between clenched teeth during the beating, but she did not scream nor cry. Now she turned around, difficult as it was in her bound position, so that she could look the flushed and exhilarated Helena Sverka's daughter in the eye, and then, snarling between clenched teeth and with her eyes black with hate, she said something so appalling that a gasp of horror passed through the hall. "One day, Helena Sverka's daughter, you shall regret those lashes more than anything else in your life. I swear it by the Holy Virgin Mary." These words were unconscionable, not just because they expressed threats and anger intramuros, nor because she had involved Our Lady in her sin, but primarily because these words showed that Cecilia Blanca had not accepted the justice of her punishment and thus had not obeyed Mother Rikisa. What everyone now anticipated was three times three new lashes with the scourge.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.